Content or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nacho Average Murder by Maddie Day, narrated by Laural Merlington. Chapter 1. Like Dorothy in Oz, I definitely wasn't in Indiana anymore. At least the Wicked Witch hadn't shown up. Yet. The sun had just dipped into the Pacific Ocean, and a mild Santa Barbara breeze shushed through tall palm trees. Mellow jazz slid out of speakers in a spacious function hall facing the water with glass doors open to a wide patio. The Chumash High School 10th Reunion Committee had organized every detail. I sipped a glass of Pinot Noir from a winery located less than an hour's drive away in the Santa Ynez Mountains behind us, and nervously adjusted my favorite turquoise shoulder bag. So far, I hadn't seen anybody I really wanted to hang out with tonight. But people were still coming in, and I knew Alana Lieberman would be here, my bestie and constant companion from our high school days. I felt a tap on my shoulder and turned to see a different former classmate.
Robbie Jordan,
Jason Wong said. What a surprise! I thought you moved back east somewhere. I looked up at my slender friend.
Jason, it's awesome to see you.
Indiana is east of here, for sure, but nearly half the country is beyond it. I'd had the same notion when I was growing up here on the West Coast. We all considered anywhere on the other side of the Rocky Mountains to be back east. I wouldn't miss this reunion for anything. He lowered his voice.
I heard about your mom, Rob. I'm so sorry.
I smiled at the nickname he and Alana had called me by.
Thanks. It's been 2 years now. I still miss her, especially being back in all the familiar places.
I blew out a breath and drew my light sweater a little closer around me. The sleeveless flowered dress I'd chosen wasn't quite warm enough for the evening, and I was glad I'd brought the wrap.
What are you up to?
I'm a proud member of the SBPD.
He pushed up his glasses.
The police department?
Yes. I'm kind of their tech detective. Some of the older guys, well, they're not really up on digital anything. I investigate cybercrime, internet forensics, the works.
That's awesome. Or what did we say? That's sick.
We'd been on math team together and had been buddies all through high school. He snorted.
Good thing that phrase went the way of the dodo. So what do you do in Iowa?
Jason, it's Indiana.
You're such a Californian.
Anyway, I own a country store. I have a breakfast and lunch restaurant downstairs, B&B rooms upstairs, and an apartment at the back of the building. It's a pretty sweet setup.
So the crossword queen goes all proprietor on us. I like it.
I do too.
I glanced at the ID on his lanyard, which featured his senior picture. Man, you look 12 in that photo. He pointed at mine.
And you don't.
What can you do?
I shook my head.
Are you married? Have kids?
No to both. Going to college and then making it through the academy took up all my time. Still hoping to settle down, though. You?
I had a brief but disastrous marriage right after college. Now I've found a solid boyfriend, but that's as far as we've gotten.
Glad you snagged a good man.
I was too.
Abe O'Neill was as good as they come. I looked around. Clumps of classmates, all of us nearly 30, stood talking, laughing, reconnecting. Sure, people were cleaned up and in nice clothes, but everybody still seemed to be in pretty good shape. I idly mused on what we would look like in 40 years at our 50th reunion. More paunch, for sure, plus gray dyed or no hair, depending. An arm went around my shoulder.
Hey, girlfriend, what's up?
Alana said. I twisted to see her.
Hey, you!
I threw both arms around her for a long overdue embrace. We pulled apart to stand grinning stupidly at each other.
She'd been my puzzling friend, my biking companion, and my confidant. I moved east and she'd slid north to Berkeley to put her doctorate in biochemistry to good use in some high-powered lab. Despite keeping in touch online, we hadn't seen each other in person since graduation.
You guys need to get a room or something?
Jason elbowed me.
Shut up, Wong.
My petite friend exchanged fist bumps with him.
How you been? Keeping the city safe?
She wore her auburn hair in a no-nonsense ear-length cut, as usual, and tonight she dressed in a green silk top and loose dark pants. Alana had never been one for skirts.
Doing what I can, he said. Have you figured out a cure for cancer?
Working on it,
Alana told him.
Really?
I asked. She gave a little shrug.
Robbie, you know there are all kinds of cancers, but yes, we are micromillimetering our way closer to...
A fingers-in-the-mouth whistle split the air. We turned toward the side of the room where a woman stood. I looked again. It was Catherine Russom. Not my favorite person from our school days. The buzz of conversation quieted. She waved both hands in the air.
Welcome to our 10th Chumash reunion, everybody. You've all got your name tags, so don't hesitate to go find your former best friend, or worst enemy, and tell them how much better they look now.
She paused, clearly expecting a laugh. When nothing more than a polite smattering of chuckles resulted, she flicked back shoulder-length blonde hair and continued.
We did pretty well getting nearly 100 of you here out of a class of 250. Who came from farthest away?
I surveyed the room. On the other side of the crowd, a man waved his hand. He was tall enough that I could see dark hair already starting to recede.
Sydney, Australia.
Wow!
Let's give it up for Joe Abrams, Catherine clapped.
Anybody from back east?
Jason pointed to my head, so I raised my hand. It's only halfway back, but Indiana. Catherine peered.
Robbie Jordan?
Her mouth twisted like she'd tasted a moldy tortilla.
Hi, everybody, I called out. It's great to be back.
Mostly. Catherine cleared her throat.
The buffet is all ready, so load up a plate. We have a killer entertainment lined up after dinner.
Jason glanced at me and murmured, if she'd ever encountered a real killer, she wouldn't use the word so lightly.
No kidding, I said.
Alana knows this, but you probably don't. I've been involved in solving several homicide cases in the last couple of years. He raised a surprised eyebrow.
No way, Rob. Truth?
Truth. Alana nodded.
She told me about at least one of the cases. The guy in the ice?
She shivered.
That sounded like a nightmare.
It kind of was, I agreed. Small town life isn't always the quiet, cozy existence people think it must be.
Even here in paradise.
Jason gestured to the rose-colored clouds and white sand outside the doors.
We aren't immune to crime.
I shook my head slowly.
No, I bet you aren't.
Chapter 2. The buffet food was way better than I'd expected. The chef presented a creamy lime chili cilantro treatment on the halibut, a light Asian dressing on a soba noodle salad studded with slivers of colorful vegetables, and flaky empanadas with a cheesy chicken filling. A perfectly Californian meal. The wines were from Los Olivos, and the bartender also had two taps from the Telegraph Brewing Company on offer. As we ate, Jason, Alana, and I caught up with several other classmates at our table, all of whom had stayed in the area. Nobody had brought spouses or significant others, and only one had started a family. When Alana used her left hand to lift her wine glass, I caught a flash of starlight.
Give me that hand, I demanded.
She blushed and extended it. the fourth finger of which was adorned with a fat diamond on a slender gold band.
When? I asked in mock anger. Who? And how didn't I know this?
Hey, it's not like I've had a chance to tell you, Alana said. His name is Antonio Lacambria. We work together, and we don't have a date yet. Her smile was sweeter than homemade peach ice cream. He only asked me a couple of weeks ago.
Congratulations, Al, I said with a stupid grin. I'm really happy for you.
Is he Italian?
Yes, his parents are Jews from Rome, but Antonio was born in San Francisco.
Your marriage linen monogram will be perfect for both of you, I said. A-L.
Not that we're the monogram type, Alana scoffed.
But yeah, we happen to share initials. Kind of perfect, in my mind.
Jason lifted his drink.
To Mrs. Al.
The three of us clinked glasses, and our classmates across the table raised theirs, too. Alana gave us more details about her freshly minted fiancé for a few minutes while we dined. Catherine, making the rounds, greeting each table, approached us.
How's everything, kids?
A cloud of perfume came with her, way too strong for my taste.
The food is outstanding, I began.
Thank you. I selected the city's hottest young chef.
Jason cleared his throat.
Catherine, I thought the committee did the selection.
She lifted her chin and waved away his correction.
Of course, of course. Robbie, I expect you don't get much of interest to eat back there in Ohio.
My new mantra seemed to be geographical correction. It's Indiana, and we happen to have some excellent chefs in the area.
Robbie's a chef herself, Jason said.
I heard you were a short order cook.
Catherine pushed a strand of hair lightly off her temple with a ring-free left hand. I smiled at her. How else to diffuse this grudge she'd apparently been harboring for more than a decade? I didn't care what she thought of me. I was happy in supporting myself doing what I loved.
And what do you do?
I run a wedding planning company. We handle all the details, right down to the bridesmaid shoes.
Alana regarded her.
You'd be good at that stuff. I enjoy it, Catherine said.
You still burying yourself in a lab, Alana?
Quite happily so, yes.
She tilted her head and gave Catherine a little smile.
You didn't much care for lab classes, did you?
I shot a glance at Alana. I knew what she meant. She'd been paired with Catherine for an experiment in biology class once, and had reported back that Catherine hadn't done any of the work.
No, I didn't.
Catherine blinked.
So why didn't your buddy Zoe show tonight, Robbie?
Right. I hadn't spotted my childhood friend Zoe Stover here.
I haven't seen her in years, Catherine. I have no idea why she didn't come.
Catherine rolled her eyes a touch, as if she didn't believe me.
She didn't register for the reunion? I asked.
Catherine shook her head.
Do you still play beach volleyball?
Alana asked her.
You were pretty competitive at that, as I recall.
Still am. Our team wins nearly every game.
Catherine mimed a serve, making the muscles in her tanned bare upper arm stand out.
We have pickup games every Friday, if any of you are interested.
I certainly wasn't. Get into a game I'd never been good at with someone who preferred to win?
Not for me.
Catherine gazed at the others at the table.
If any of you need my services, you know where to find me. Enjoy the evening.
She headed for the next table.
Didn't she marry Bill Lombard?
Jason asked the group.
I wouldn't think she'd be the type not to change her name.
The woman next to him, a former cheerleader, leaned closer.
She did, with a wedding straight out of central casting and several hundred guests. But the marriage only lasted a year. She dropped Bill's name like a ghost chili and went back to Daddy's.
The strum of an electric guitar caught everybody's attention.
Good evening, Jew Mashers. Ready for some music? The guitarist and his four fellow musicians had been in a garage band in high school, and it looked like they were having a reunion themselves. "We're the Buffo Barnacles, and we're going to entice you onto the dance floor. Get set to pull out your best high school moves." They launched into a song by Katy Perry. "My best high school moves were standing with my back to the wall, watching everybody else dance." Jason laughed, shaking his head. "Mine was not even going to the dances," I said. "Come on, Rob." He stood. "Let's give it a try anyway."
"Sure. I'm way beyond caring what anybody thinks of my dance style."
Jason and I danced most of the next hour, with Alana joining us for a few songs. At one point, the band switched to oldies, and somebody brought out a limbo stick. My low center of gravity and bicyclist's power thighs got me in the final three, as the stick went lower and lower. But I finally fell over sideways. I laughed and scrambled out of the way of a nimble and still petite former gymnast, who ended up the winner. After the music switched to a more Latin beat, Hector Perez approached me, a guy I hadn't known well at high school. He'd been on the dance floor since the music started, and the dude had moves worthy of the contestants on Dancing with the Stars. "Robbie, right?" he asked. His dark hair curled onto his neck, and an open-collar black shirt was snug on his uber-fit torso.
"Hi, Hector. How are you?"
"Great." He flashed me a white smile. "Would you like to dance?" I accepted. I proceeded to have the dance of a lifetime, despite never having partnered with anyone during a salsa number. The man knew how to lead. With subtle pressures of his hands on mine, gently steering me in the right direction, his gaze locked on my face all the while, wearing a sweet half-smile. I felt like the modern Latin version of Ginger Rogers. I didn't step on his feet once. After the song ended, he thanked me and gave a little bow. He went off to ask another woman for the next number. I took a deep breath and headed smiling for the drinks table to grab a glass of water. When the band took a break, Catherine summoned us all for a class picture.
"You'll remember the drill. Tall dudes in the back, middles in the middle row, shorties in the front. Oh, and class officers in the middle of the first row."
Jason and I exchanged a look. He rolled his eyes. "Madam former president needs to get a life." I bobbed my head in agreement, but went to claim a place in the first row, being all of 5'3" when I stood up real straight. Somehow I ended up near the middle next to Catherine, despite my not having held office. The photographer stood on a chair in front of us, calling out adjustments for people to move a little to their left or right. "Remember, if you can't see me, I can't see you," Catherine muttered through her smile.
"I've never forgiven you, you know."
I turned to stare at her.
"What?
Forgiven me for what?"
"Smile at the camera, Robbie."
I obeyed, but my brain was in overdrive. She couldn't still be mad about... "All eyes up here," the photographer instructed, waving her hand next to her head. "Happy cheese!" She took a half dozen shots. "It's a wrap. Thanks, gang. The committee will have the best shot within the week." Catherine began talking to the person on her other side. I started to extend my hand to touch her elbow, to ask her what she meant. I dropped it instead. I expected I'd never see her again after tonight. What happened back then didn't matter to me, and if she wanted to nurse an old hurt, imagined or real, it was her business, not mine.
Chapter 3.
My internal clock was still set to Eastern Standard Time since I'd flown in only the previous day. I awoke at 3 a.m. the next morning, plagued by thoughts of what had gone down at the reunion. The only thing I could think of between Catherine and me was the time Bill Lombard had asked me on a date. I knew she'd had her eye on him because she'd talked about her crush in gym class. He and I hadn't become a thing, and she'd gone on to snatch him up. And then they'd apparently gotten divorced. which certainly had nothing to do with me. I'd gotten married and divorced myself. I managed to slip back into dreamland after an hour, only aroused at 7:30 by the aromas of coffee, bacon, and something baking drifting upstairs to my B&B room. A quick shower later, I locked my room. I headed for the stairs, ready to sample whatever was on the menu for breakfast, or inhale it, as the case may be. The Nacho Average Cafe was already hopping when I walked in.
"Good morning, Robbie,"
proprietor Carmen Perez called out from the pass-through window to the kitchen in the back.
"Sit wherever you like."
"Thanks." I slid into a seat at a two-top near the front window. I smiled to myself at her name. Carmen was the nickname I'd given my phone. The decor here was delightfully Cali-Mex, with hues of red, orange, and green predominating. Mexican folk art murals decorated the walls, and a dozen papier-mâché angels and clothed Day of the Dead skeletons were suspended from the ceiling. The cloth napkin at my setting was red, too. A glass door opened onto a patio dining area, where a rosemary bush the size of a sea lion grew next to the low fence, and ripe oranges hung from the glossy-leaved tree just beyond. Nope, not in Indiana. The only familiar bit was a tuxedo cat snoozing in a spot of sun on the paving stones outside. He could have been my birdie's twin. I perused the menu, eyes widening at the mention of avocado huevos rancheros and orange scones. My stomach growled out loud. I glanced around, but none of the other 24 diners appeared to have heard. Some wore running outfits, and a couple on the patio had a leashed golden retriever sitting under their table.
"Coffee?"
Carmen appeared at my side, pot of Java in hand.
"Did you sleep well?"
In her 50s, she wore a long salt-and-pepper braid down her back, but with a streak dyed bright red decorating the right side. She'd tied on an orange apron featuring the cafe's logo around her comfortable figure.
"Coffee, please."
And, considering jet lag, I did all right in the sleep department.
"Good."
She filled my mug.
"How was your reunion last night?"
"Wonderful, truly." I caught up with a number of old friends. I cocked my head, thinking, "Wait, do you have a son named Hector?"
"Yes, of course."
High beams had nothing on Carmen's smile. "He told me he was going." "I didn't connect your name with him before. We weren't close in high school, but man, can Hector ever dance. I have no idea how to officially dance salsa, but he made me feel like I'd been doing it for years. Best dance I've ever had."
"That's Hector's passion, but he's a chef too, you know."
"Really?"
"He went to culinary school instead of college. He's worked a few places, but now he has a food truck at the harbor."
"Awesome. I'll have to check it out this week." I pointed to the cat.
"What's his name?"
"Pajarito." She pronounced it Pajarito, trilling the R like the native Spanish speaker she was.
"Little bird."
"Yes."
"I have his twin, and his name is Birdie."
"Does yours have 6 toes?
"He does. That's amazing, right?"
I glanced around the room. "I love the decor here, Carmen."
"Thanks, I do too."
She set one fist on her waist and smiled. "It was Janine who suggested decorating the restaurant like this after I bought the building." My eyes widened.
"You knew my mom?"
"I sure did. We were in the Unitarian Women's Book Group together." "I still miss her a lot."
"And you must miss her even more."
My throat thickened. I swallowed away the emotion.
"I do."
Carmen touched my shoulder.
"I'm sorry. I shouldn't have brought up her death."
"It's okay. It's just that out here there are so many reminders of her and what we used to do together." I cleared my throat and gestured at the menu.
"So what do you recommend? Everything sounds yummy."
"The avocado huevos are popular. I grow the avocados out back. The eggs are from a local farmer, and my mom makes the tortillas."
"Mama!" she called toward the kitchen.
Diga hola, Robbie.
A woman's face appeared in the kitchen window.
Hola, Robbie.
So short her head barely made the window. She wore the same braid as her daughter, but hers was whiter than a flour tortilla. She smiled from ear to ear and waved a strong working woman's hand. I waved back.
You're so lucky to have her working with you, I said to Carmen. What's her name, or should I call her Mama?
Carmen let out a hearty laugh. Luisa Sandoval, but everybody calls her Mama. She taught me everything I know about cooking.
I can't wait to taste it. I'll have the avocado huevos rancheros, please, and an orange scone, too.
You got it. The oranges are also my own. You want a mimosa or a Bloody Mary with your meal? You're on vacation, right? I gave it a 2-second consideration. You're right. I am. I'd close my restaurant so my two employees and I could have a much-needed break. Since I was already paying to fly west, I'd decided to stay a week and warm up my feet while I was here, replenish my soul on views of ocean and mountains, and feed my body on fresh, delicious, creative meals, picking up recipes to take back in the process. I'd love a Bloody Mary. Heck, I didn't have anywhere in particular to go, and I could nurse it after I ate. Bueno. She looked around, then lowered her voice.
Robbie, I heard something was fishy about your mom's death.
What? What do you mean, fishy? She died of an aneurysm.
Didn't she? That's what they said. But a diner on the patio hailed her, and Mama rang their version of a foods ready bell. I'll tell you later. I need to get working.
I know how it is. I'll be around until Saturday. Plenty of time to talk. I sipped my dark roast coffee and watched her hurry off. What could she possibly mean by fishy? Sure, Mom died alone, but the death certificate had listed aneurysm as the cause. The medical examiner's office couldn't have gotten it wrong. Could they?
Chapter 4. Before I took the first bite, I snapped a picture of my died-and-gone-to-heaven breakfast. 2 fried eggs on refried black beans, atop a corn tortilla covered with slices of a perfectly ripe avocado, and chunky homemade salsa, with a dollop of sour cream on top and more warm tortillas on the side. I posted it to the Pans N Pancakes Instagram account with a message reading, March Breakfast Special? Could happen. I added a hashtag of, hashtag not in Indiana anymore, Dorothy, which made me smile. I had a perfectly healthy number of followers, and they weren't all Hoosiers either. I imagined them smiling too. I thought of keeping a little notebook for meal ideas, but the pictures would jog my memory about the ingredients. I sniffed, loving the toasty smell of the tortillas, one of my favorite things to eat. I'd savored the first bite of the dish when my phone dinged with a text. I'd been trying to reach my mom's good friend, Liz Stover. Her daughter and I had been friends growing up, and the two mothers had kept up their friendship in the years since graduation. Zoe and me? Not so much. We'd drifted apart during high school, and neither of us had made an effort to stay in touch. Before I'd come downstairs this morning, I'd texted Liz, where I was going to eat breakfast, and asked about a walk on the beach later. Liz now replied, on my way to NAC. Walk after sounds good.
NAC.
After a second, I realized NAC was Nacho Average Cafe. Cool. Maybe she would know something about Mom's death. Or maybe not. What I really wanted was to simply be with Liz, reminisce about my mother, and find out what she'd been up to. Another text dinged in. I smiled when I read Abe's message. Got 6 inches of white overnight, heading out to snowshoe. Wish you were here. I tapped a message back. Wearing flip-flops and shorts, walking on the beach later. Wish you were here.
I did wish he was here to enjoy my birthplace with me, and I had invited him to come along. He'd said he didn't want to intrude on the reunion, and anyway, he was slated to teach a new employee training during the week. I sipped my Bloody Mary, which was nice and spicy, exactly how I liked it. Carmen had served it in a heavy blue Mexican tumbler. I loved the feel of those glasses, and resolved then and there to pick up a set and take them home. I swooned after I bit into the scone. The orange was tangy and sweet, and the crumb perfect. Maybe Carmen would share the recipe. By the time Liz arrived, I was halfway through the huevos and slowing down. The meal was super filling. I stood to give her a hug, then sat.
"Ooh, Bloody Mary?"
She raised her eyebrows. "Sounds great." She pulled out the chair opposite me, her spiked silver hair catching the morning light. Her skin was the weathered brown of a sun lover, which made the blue of her eyes pop. "I love your jacket." I admired the vertical stripes of turquoise and purple on the woven cloth. "Did you make the cloth?"
"I did, and I sewed the jacket, too. Weaving is the best antidote to lawyering I can imagine. It's very meditative to sit and combine threads into something beautiful."
Carmen approached.
"Hey, Liz, we gotta stop meeting like this."
She glanced at me. "We just had book club on Wednesday."
"Can I get one of those? But go light on the vodka."
Liz pointed to my drink. "And the veggie breakfast burrito sounds great, with extra guac." "Coming right up." Carmen headed back to the kitchen. "My mom makes the best guacamole you'll ever taste," Liz said. "I'll have to try it this week." "So how have you been?"
"Busy. Good.
Got a new boyfriend who's pretty awesome. He's still surfing at 66. My kind of man." "You probably haven't stopped taking a board out either," I said.
"Of course not. It's in my blood, Robbie.
I've been riding the wave since I was a toddler, almost." "You never surfed much, did you?"
"No. I got conked in the head once in middle school and decided staying alive was better than drowning. That's when I started biking for real. And since Mom grew up in Indiana, she never got into surfing after she moved out here."
"I remember trying to teach her. It definitely wasn't her thing," Liz laughed.
"So tell me about the reunion."
"It was fine, with only a little high school level drama." I wrinkled my nose, thinking again of Catherine. "Anyway, the food was fabulous, very fresh and light, and I caught up with old friends. Alana Lieberman and I were tied in school, but we hadn't seen each other in person since we both left town."
"I remember her. Super smart."
"Yep. She got a PhD and is doing pretty important cancer research already."
"And do you remember Jason Wong? Skinny kid? Brilliant?"
"Yeah. He's a police officer now," I said. "Works on cybercrime."
"I'm not surprised he's a cop. He was always a straight arrow."
"I'm sure he's good at the job." Carmen delivered Liz's drink and breakfast. "Careful, the plate's hot. Enjoy." Liz thanked her. "I didn't see Zoe at the reunion," I said. "How is she? We haven't really kept in touch." The smile slipped off Liz's face.
"She's having kind of a rough patch. She's not really in shape to hang out with a bunch of successful former classmates."
"I'm sorry to hear that."
"At least she's working. But it's only as a dishwasher at a restaurant, the Green Artichoke."
She tapped her fork on her plate in a slow rhythm, not meeting my gaze. I studied her face.
"Do you want to talk about her?"
She inhaled and mustered a smile.
"Not right now. Let's have a fun breakfast, shall we?"
She lifted her glass. "Here's to Janine." I clinked my glass with hers. "To Mom." Chapter 5. I waited to bring up what Carmen had said about Mom's death until Liz and I were walking on East Beach. A line of tall king palms separated the road from the sand, their skinny trunks topped with tufts of swooping fronds.
A paved walking and biking path wound next to the trees, but we'd chosen to tread at water's edge. It was 9 o'clock by now, under a cloudless sky. Liz pulled a wide-brimmed cotton hat firmly onto her head.
"You might not know I had a brush with melanoma 3 years ago," she said in a grim tone. "All my years in the sun have come back to bite me. Luckily, the doc caught it early, but I don't mess around now." "I didn't know. I'm glad you're okay."
I tugged my blue Pans N Pancakes hat a little lower on my head. "I got this Mediterranean skin from my Italian father. I tan easily, but I still try to be careful in the sun." Liz nodded.
"Janine told me about Roberto a little while before she died."
I stared at her.
"She did? She never said anything to me. I had to discover him on my own." "She said she was planning on telling you the whole story in person the next time she went east for a visit."
I dragged my feet to a halt, pressing my eyes shut for a moment.
"And she never got the chance." "I'm sorry, honey."
Liz threw an arm around my shoulders and squeezed.
"Your mom told me she felt bad for keeping it from you."
"I met my father last year when he and his wife came to visit. I have mom's build, but I look exactly like him, Liz."
"I expect you do."
I hugged myself, watching a half dozen pelicans beat strong wide wings in a steady horizontal line above the ocean. "Let's keep walking." We strode in silence for a few minutes. The damp sand near the water crunched under my bare feet, and the breeze was fresh and salty. I breathed deeply, shaking out my sadness.
"Are you happy back there, Robbie?"
Liz asked.
"You look good, you know, like you're thriving."
"I am. My country store and restaurant are staying in the black. I like what I do. It's awesome being near my Aunt Adele, and I've made some good friends."
"What about love?"
"Love, too." My cheeks warmed. "I have a great guy, Abe."
"Yeah? Love's good, too."
"I'm glad. Janine would have been so happy to know you found someone."
"She would."
I blew out a breath. "Liz, earlier Carmen mentioned she'd heard something was fishy about Mom's death. Do you know what she was talking about?" Liz waited a beat.
"Did Janine ever tell you about the environmental group she was involved with?"
"No, I don't think she did." "Did they have something to do with her death?"
"Hang on. Let me talk this through."
"The group, and your mom, were trying to get certain agricultural chemicals banned from the region. They made a couple of conventional farmers and the chemical company pretty mad." A little girl of about 6, bucket in hand, dashed directly in front of us toward the water, followed closely by a boy the same size.
"Kids never look where they're going."
Liz gave a wry laugh.
"Anyway, after your mom died, one of the guys in the group contacted me. He knew she and I were friends. He had a lot of questions about the circumstances of her death."
"What?" I stared at her.
"What kinds of questions?"
She gazed at me.
"Maybe you should ask him yourself. His name's Paul Echeverria. I'll text you his info and how to spell his name, which is Basque or something."
"Mom died alone of an aneurysm. What else is there to know?" I threw my hands open. "Would a medical examiner have gotten it wrong?" Liz paused for a few moments.
"I was the one who found her."
I nodded slowly, my eyes on the horizon. 4 boxy oil rigs rose up about 10 miles out. Behind them, the Channel Islands were clear today, especially Santa Cruz, the largest. Its 22 miles of gently sloping ridges rose up like a giant blue woman sleeping on the water. Liz had found my mom lying down too, but not asleep.
"I was supposed to pick her up for book group, and she didn't answer the door or her phone."
Liz's voice was low and somber,
We'd given each other keys years before, just in case. I let myself in and discovered her on the kitchen floor. She'd been gone a while, I guess. You told me about finding her when I came out for her memorial service, but I had forgotten until now. Or maybe I subconsciously blanked it out. I swiped at a tear. Was there something odd about the way she was lying there? Or did her breath smell funny? I mean, I thought she simply fell down dead. That was what it looked like. I didn't notice anything odd, but I think you should talk to Paul. Here, let me send you his info now. She sank to sit on the sand and worked her phone. I took a few steps to the water. Nobody was out there swimming for a reason. The water lapping over my feet was frigid. But for my entire life, I'd never let myself visit a beach without dipping a toe in the ocean, winter or summer. I backed up a few steps to watch a tern dive bomb the water and come up with the fish wriggling in its black beak. I couldn't believe my mother hadn't died of natural causes. Her death had been an enormous shock, because she'd been healthy and in her 50s. But if this guy Liz knew had suspicions about her death, that would mean murder. And I didn't want that. The thought that someone might have wanted Mom dead, that malice had dive-bombed her, made me shudder. I tried to shake off the feeling. As I watched the ocean, a sleek body farther out dipped in and out of the water, followed by three more. "Look, Liz, dolphins," I pointed. "We sure don't see those in Indiana." "Nice." She boosted herself up to stand. "I told Paul you might call him. He texted back that their group is meeting this afternoon at 2. Said you're welcome to join them." "I'll contact him, thanks. I at least want to hear what he has to say. I'd planned to go for a hike in the mountains this afternoon, or maybe borrow one of the bikes Carmen had available for guests and ride up the coast a ways. I would be here all week. Such a ride could wait. And tomorrow I'd ask Jason if he could put me in touch with the person who declared Mom's death a natural one. I wished I could hire Kinsey Milhone to dig into this mystery. I'd read that the Santa Teresa Sue Grafton had invented was a thinly disguised Santa Barbara. But since Kinsey was fictional, I was going to have to do this myself. Chapter 6. After I locked the bike I'd borrowed from Carmen for a ride around the city, I meandered toward the lake in the middle of Alice Keck Park, a green oasis downtown. I checked the time on my phone. Paul had said he would find me here at 4 after his meeting, so I told him what I looked like. He'd invited me to attend his gathering first, but hanging out with environmentalists wasn't what I was after. I only wanted to hear his thoughts about my mother's death. It was nearly 4, and the winter sun was already on its decline. I shivered and pulled the zipper on my fleece all the way up. I hoped he wouldn't be late. The bike didn't have a light, so I needed to get back to Carmen's before darkness fell in an hour and a half. A ratty sleeping bag stuck out from behind a tall silver maple tree, and a head of matted hair was nearly hidden in the bag. I'd seen other homeless people around town, many more than had been in evidence 10 years ago. The economy was taking its toll, and in a warm climate like this one, it wasn't life-threatening for them to sleep outside year-round, unlike in Indiana. Still, I felt bad that anyone had to live without a roof over their head. I kept going until I walked over a wooden bridge spanning a burbling stream. It coursed down a few smooth stones into the small artificial lake. Mallards, seagulls, and black-and-white geese paddled around, with a cormorant perched on a rock in the middle of the water. The pond had a fresh water smell that reminded me of Lake Lemon back home. I was watching a dozen turtles sunning themselves on a log in the shallows when a deep voice behind me said,
"Robbie Jordan."
I turned to see a tall, wiry man carrying a bike helmet.
Yes. Are you Paul?
That would be me.
His curly black hair formed a wild nimbus around his head. He was probably 10 or 15 years older than me, and wore a plaid shirt and faded jeans with the right pants leg still rolled up from his ride. I shook his proffered hand.
Shall we sit?
He gestured toward a bench by the side of the lake and cleared his throat after we sat.
First, let me offer my condolences on your mother's passing. She was a wonderful woman.
Thank you. She was. I looked more closely at him. Wait. You were at her memorial service.
Yes.
I thought you looked familiar. His name hadn't rung any bells when Liz mentioned it, but I'm good with faces. I knew I'd seen him before.
I didn't get a chance to speak to you after the service,
he continued.
I had to go straight to work. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I was pretty dazed at the time. What do you do for work?
I bike deliver takeout meals for the Green Artichoke. It's a low-carbon footprint local foods restaurant down in the Funk Zone. They make quite good food and have a philosophy I can get behind.
Sounds interesting. It wasn't there when I was growing up. Somebody else had mentioned the Green Artichoke, but I couldn't think who at the moment.
Liz said you were interested in my thoughts about Janine.
His expression was intense, his dark eyebrows pulled together in the middle. His knee jittered up and down, and he seemed to be avoiding making eye contact with me. Everybody seems to think something was off about her death, I said slowly. This is the first I've heard of it. What do you know?
She'd been active in our group for a few years. We were working hard to get some of the most toxic fumigants banned in Ventura and Santa Barbara counties.
What, like chemicals they use for termite fumigation?
No. They're used in strawberry fields, which you must know are common near the coast. There's a tiny pest called a nematode that eats strawberry roots, so the farmers essentially sterilize the soil before planting.
Sterilizing soil sounds awful.
It is. These chemicals are neurotoxins. They don't get into the berries, or so the chemical companies claim. But when the fumigants are sprayed, it's extremely dangerous for the health of the farm workers and neighbors because it's airborne. People and animals can't help but breathe it.
Wow. That's terrible.
No kidding. An alpaca farmer next to one of the big strawberry farms in Oxnard says her animals got sick. The farm worker's health suffers. It's bad news, Robbie.
Oxnard was the flat, fertile coastal plain not far down the coast from here beyond Ventura. There must be an alternative for farmers, I said. Something organic, maybe. He grimaced.
The alternative is for them to rotate their crops and use organic products. They don't want to. Big farmers monocrop as cheaply as they can, grow the same product in the same place year-round, and strip the soil of any natural defenses so people all over the country can eat big, juicy California strawberries whenever they want.
Ouch. I'd think twice next time I was tempted to buy strawberries in February.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.